The Somerville Foundation Annual Conference 2014. Valve Replacement by Herring Van Dorn, Consultant Lead Cardiac Surgery, Leeds General Infirmary. About the speaker. Miss Herring Van Dorn is the Head of Congenital Cardiac Surgery at the LGI, Leeds General Infirmary. She specialises in paediatric and adult congenital surgery, with special interest in complex aortic root surgery, mechanical cardiac assistance, and establishing sustainable humanitarian cardiac programs.
Hi, good morning. It's fantastic to see so many people here. I was asked to talk about this subject because I gathered there was particular interest from an request from the patients to talk about this. Before I start talking about valve replacement, I just quickly go through the way heart valves are organized in the heart. And there are four heart valves, two on the right hand side and two on the left hand side of the heart. Every chamber has an inflow valve and has an outflow valve. And on the right-hand side, it is the tricuspid valve, is the inflow valve, and the pulmonary valve, the exit valve. And on the left side, which is the high-pressure side of the circulation, the mitral valve is the inflow valve, and the aortic valve is the outflow. As you can see in the slide next to it, the outflow valves have the same basic design, and the inflow valves also look more or less the same. So what type of problems do we get with heart valves? Well, they're generally either narrow, so there is valve stenosis, and again on the picture here on the right hand side, this is a normal functioning valve. So if you look at the left top end picture, the blood goes in from the left collecting chamber, from the left atrium, and then goes through the valve to the left pumping chamber. And then normally it is one-way traffic, and it should just all go out through the aorta, and none should come back because the mitral valve is closed. If there is valve stenosis, which is the picture on the right lower side, then the blood has difficulty getting into the left pumping chamber, and there will be pooling of blood in the collecting chamber with back pressure on the lungs. On the other hand, if there is valve regurgitation, then some of the blood that really should go out of the left pumping chamber actually leaks back. Quite often there is not pure an isolated narrowing or leakage, but there is quite often a combination of problems. What are the reasons for these heart valve problems? A number of them are congenital, they're inborn. Quite often, if you have an inborn heart valve problem, there may also be other cardiac abnormalities present. However, valve disease is actually very common. And even if you're born with a normally built heart, then you quite often get valve problems at later age. And valves may also malfunction as a result of infection, rheumatic heart disease, or as a result of an operation or a catheter intervention. And if you have congenital heart disease, then again, you may still be prone to infection. So, what are the indications for valve surgery? Because having an abnormally built valve in its own right is not a reason to have it replaced as long as it functions well. First of all, there are symptoms. So, if valves are narrowed or stenosed, you quite often get a reduction in exercise ability, you become short of breath, or you may get palpitations, and occasionally you may get lightheadedness. If these symptoms arise, then it is quite easy to get a better picture of the valve, and I'm sure most of you will have had a cardiac ultrasound in the outpatient department, and some people will also have had an MRI scan. To get a better handle on what the effect is of that malfunctioning valve on the heart, we do other tests like an ECG or a stress test, and that gives us an idea how the heart muscle itself copes with that malfunctioning valve. Valves rarely suddenly fail. They usually gradually fail over time, and therefore it is important to have a series of observations. So a 6-monthly, yearly, or 2-yearly echo in the outpatient department. And sometimes actually you can have a valve that is very stable, but your own condition may change. And a particular example is pregnancy. So you may have a valve that works well under normal conditions, but the extra load on the circulation related to pregnancy may mean that actually that valve may need replacing prior to becoming pregnant. The indications for valve surgery are therefore quite complex, and for patients with acquired heart disease, where you can standardize to a great extent what are the reasons for performing valve surgery, there are guidelines that come either from Europe, and the last update from Europe is from 2012. Or similar guidelines are also published from North America. And these guidelines are really work in progress, and they are adapted regularly, taking into account new ways of treating patients. But how does this translate for indications for valve surgery for patients with congenital heart disease? In patients who have acquired heart problems, they're quite often older. The patients with congenital heart problems are generally younger, and any valve surgery has to be seen as a lifetime investment in the management of the congenital heart disease of that patient, and that may have an impact on decision making. Sometimes the heart valve problems actually already need treatment when you are in childhood, and then small size or a need for growth is an important consideration. Also, as I already mentioned, sometimes there are other cardiac abnormalities present that may also require an intervention, and then a valve that may need an intervention, that sometimes that intervention is brought forward because you're having an operation already. On the other hand, sometimes the valve intervention may be very high risk because patients already have had a number of previous operations to deal with other problems of their heart. Also, although you asked me to talk about valve replacement, I think it is really important to know that there is an increasing role for valve sparing procedures, so where we repair the valve and a patient keeps their own valve. And also there is an increasing role for catheter interventions where valves can be stretched or now also increasingly replaced without having to resort to major surgery. Briefly on valve repairs, obviously we should only repair the valve if we can have a durable repair. That doesn't necessarily mean that the repair has to last a lifetime, but we would expect that repair definitely to last a decade, and that may sometimes be very useful for a patient if the patient still has any growing to do, or if the patient, say, doesn't want to take blood thinning medicines for a period of their life. We are getting better at doing these valve repairs because we have a better understanding why these valves fail, and therefore the repairs have become more producible. We're also much better at imaging the valves, and we now routinely do cardiac echoes in the operating theater after the patient has received an anesthetic for the operation, and we will then routinely repeat that echo before we leave the operating room to make sure that we've done the best possible repair. Also, surgical techniques have improved over the last years. But sometimes the valve is not repairable, and then we need to replace the valve. And if so, what would be the ideal valve replacement? Well, ideally, we only want to do one operation, so we would like a permanent valve replacement. We also ideally want to have a valve that is biocompatible, so it doesn't upset the blood system, and there would be no need for anticoagulation. We obviously want this valve to work perfect, so there should be no narrowing of the valve, and there should be no leakage. We want them to have easily available, just to have them on the shelf in a range of sizes, so we can do the operations as and when they arrive. And ideally, we want these valves to grow Unfortunately, that valve does not yet exist. There is a lot of research going on, but unfortunately, the valve isn't there yet. So what do we have at the moment? We have a number of different groups of valves. We've got mechanical valves, commonly called metal valves, where actually there are more metal alloys than made of. Then we have biological valves, which are made from animal tissue, generally pigs or cows. We've got human donor grafts, which are called homografts. And then there are, in selected patients, we can move valves around in the heart and we can take the patient's own pulmonary valve and move that to the aortic valve in order to get growth in that position. Also, as I said, catheter interventions are becoming more common, and the valves they use there are bioprosthetic valves because they actually have to roll them up in the catheter when they put them in. So we just spent a little bit of time talking about the pros and cons of the various heart valve substitutes. On this panel, these are some of the bioprosthetic valves that are currently available. They all have a CE mark, so they have been tested and they have been approved by the European community. Some are pigs or cows aortic valves. Some are actually man-made from a sheet of pericardium, which is the tissue that sits around the heart. But made to look like an aortic valve. Although these valves are used both to substitute the aortic valve and the mitral valve, so actually we don't have different designs for the heart prosthesis depending where you want to put them. The bioprosthetic valves have limited durability. They do wear out, and they tend to wear out quicker in younger patients. They tend to wear out quicker if you put them at the high pressure site of the heart. There is no need for anticoagulation. They come off the shelf. They have a range of sizes, but not very small sizes, so we can't really put them into a baby. And also in babies, they wear out very, very quick. And we do have homografts, which are the human donor valves, but they have currently a very limited availability. We also have metal valves, mechanical valves, and there has been a change in design over the valves. And initially it started with a cage and a ball that just popped up and down. A very primitive design, but worked very well. Currently, most of the valves that are put in are called mechanical bileaflet valves. They have two little metal leaflets that sort of move up and down. Function very, very well, and they're also very safe because if one leaflet would clot off, then the other leaflet will still open and close, and you don't have that safety valve, that safety mechanism with any of the other valves. A drawback is that these valves make the blood clot, so you need to be on blood thinning medicines, and the level of anticoagulation, how thin you make the blood, depends a little bit on in which position in the heart we put the valve in. So for aortic valves, we need the least amount of anticoagulation. For mitral valve, we need a little bit more. If we put them on the right side of the heart, where the pressures are low, and therefore there is less washing of the valve and a higher risk of clotting, we need to have a higher level of anticoagulation. These are permanent valves. They have really been very extensively tested, and the risk of mechanical valve failure, so a bit of metal flying off, is almost nil. And they come, again, in a range of sizes. I briefly touched on the ROS procedure, which is a procedure we use for aortic valve replacement in very selected patients. And on that occasion, we take the pulmonary valve, which we move to the aortic position, and then we put a human donor valve, a homograft, in a pulmonary position. And the reason why we do it in such a difficult way and don't just put the homograft in the aortic position is that homografts do wear out, and they wear out quicker if you put them in the aortic position, and they're also more difficult to replace if you put them in the aortic position. So by moving them around, we actually have a longer use of the homograft. However, this procedure makes a one-valve operation into a two-valve operation. You will need to replace the homograft in due course. There is a risk of stretching of the new aortic valve. However, in specialist centers and with the right patient selection, it is a very good operation, and it is predominantly used in leads for young children in whom we don't have very good prosthetic valves available, and also because it has growth potential. Finally, a percutaneous valve. This is a new technique that continues to develop. And essentially, it involves taking a bioprosthetic valve and rolling it up and wrapping it around the catheter. And then you can introduce that valve through an artery or through a vein, depending on which side of the heart you work. And you can then place a new aortic valve, as is illustrated here, or a new pulmonary valve, as is illustrated here. This is a new technique. It's been around for about 10 years now. It's predominantly used for aortic and pulmonary valve replacement at the moment in selected patients. But it avoids an open heart operation. The hospital stay is short. However, it is a bioprosthetic valve, and because the procedure is new, the long-term results are not yet known. So, where do we go from there? Which valve to use? Well, the choice of valve is guided by the heart condition, the left or right side of the heart. Because, as I said before, mechanical valves need less anticoagulation if you put them on the left side of the heart. On the other hand, bioprosthetic valves, their longevity is much better if we put them on the right side of the heart. So we would generally put in a patient in whom we think has a long life ahead, where we would expect that a bioprosthetic valve will wear out. We would normally have a mechanical valve on the left side of the heart and a bioprosthetic valve on the right side of the heart. However, this is not the only consideration. It also depends a little bit on the required size and sometimes on surgical consideration, what the best choice of valve procedure will be. It also depends on the tolerance for anticoagulation, because there may be, say, a young man who needs an aortic valve replacement, and he plans to go and work somewhere in the middle of Africa for the next 5 years. It's going to be very, very difficult to have reliable anticoagulation, and that patient might decide that he goes for a bioprosthetic valve, knowing that in 7 or 10 years' time he will be back to have a mechanical valve or maybe another bioprosthetic valve. It's the same with women of childbearing age. The anticoagulation does have an effect on the fetus, although with careful monitoring of anticoagulation, that effect can be reduced. However, it does make the pregnancy a little bit more difficult, and therefore some women would prefer to have a bioprosthetic valve, others prefer to have a mechanical valve. So, in patients where it is possible to have a choice what you do, it's very much also patients' preference, and it is something that is very important to bring up at the time of consultation. Because, as I said, there is no ideal valve substitute, and ultimately it is the patient who has to make a life with the valve, so it's important we have the best possible choice. Most mechanical valves will not fail. Bioprosthetic valves over time will fail, but they do fail very, very slowly. So generally you can monitor this by yearly echoes, and then you can actually plan an operation. And if we know as a surgeon that we're going to go back in, we can actually also make some preparations at the time of the operation to make a further operation more doable. But tissue files, they will wear out. But a lot of things like infection and thrombosis that can affect the valve, and both a mechanical and a bioprosthetic valve are prone to infection, so it is important to look after your teeth to avoid piercings, not to use IV drugs, and so on and so on. It is also very important to have the anticoagulation without too much ups and downs. So if your INR is run between 2 and 3, if the INR regularly runs between 1.5 and 4.5, and you have really big swings, you have a higher risk of getting valve thrombosis, and also have a higher risk of bleeding. But every year we explant a number of mechanical valves because of these reasons. So ultimately, it is your valve, look after it, and please let us know your consideration when you come to the outpatient clinic to discuss a valve replacement or repair with us. Thank you.
The Somerville Foundation, supporting young people and adults born with a heart condition. The Somerville Foundation works with patients born with a heart condition, congenital, providing practical and emotional support and enabling them to take control of their lives and manage their own heart condition. Thanks to advancements in medical treatment, today more and more people born with heart conditions are living full, long and happy lives. To learn more about the work of the Somerville Foundation, visit www.thesf.org.uk.